دي شيخ.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدنا ومولانا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا، إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب أعوذ بك من همزات الشياطين، وأعوذ بك رب أن يحضرون. تبرأت من حولي وقوتي، واعتصمت بحول الله وقوته، فلا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري، ويسر لي أمري، واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. وبعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Where to begin, my dear respected brothers, when speaking about the master of mankind, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Where to begin when we speak about the one whom Allah begin when we speak about the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never addressed in his book, in his last testament and will to mankind? He never addressed by his name, by his first name. All of the prophets were addressed by their names. Ya Ibrahim, Ya Zakariya, Ya Yahya, Ya Nuh. All of the prophets in Allah's book were addressed by their first name, except Sayyidul Mursaleen, the master of the prophets and messengers, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never addressed him except as Ya Ayyuhan Nabi, O Prophet, Ya Ayyuhar Rasul, O Messenger. And when his name was mentioned, it was not mentioned alone, but partnered and twinned with him, with his greatest attribute, being a messenger of Allah, where Allah says, Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tonight, let us start by a house rule, but it's not a house rule. It is a universal rule for all of us. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَرْفَعُوا أَصْوَاتَكُمْ فَوْقَ صَوْتِ النَّبِيِّ. O you who have believed, do not raise your voices over the voice of the messenger, over the voice of the prophet. One of the companions who had a loud voice, naturally his voice was loud. When this verse was revealed, he then feared that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be displeased with him and that he would be punished by Allah. So he would remain silent. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, this does not mean you. But what this means then for us, my dear respected brothers and sisters, is that when he is mentioned sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his guidance is taught, we do not raise our voices over the hadith. We do not speak over it. We do not give precedence or priority to our opinion over the opinion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because his opinion is not attributed to himself, rather it is revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, he who sends salah on me, Allah will send salah on him 10 times. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Where do we start? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-nabi. Indeed Allah and the angels send salah on the prophet. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. O you who have believed, send salah on him. Wa sallimu taslima, and great salutations. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad. He who sends salah and salam on the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will deserve his shafa'ah, his intercession on the Day of Judgment. Say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Unfortunately, we live in a time where mention of Allah and His Messenger are considered the topics of the foolish. We have atheists who would accuse you of foolishness and stupidity and ignorance by your mere belief in Allah. And we have, unfortunately, amongst the Muslims, vast numbers of Muslims whom, if you speak to about Allah and His Messenger, they'll look at you and they'll say, "Well, you're a Sufi or something." So that you can't send salah and salam on the Messenger. You cannot speak of love of Allah and His Messenger. You cannot speak about sacrificing yourself for the Messenger without being accused of being deviant. And of course, I am not saying that they are synonymous, tasawwuf and deviance. No, there is deviance in all of the inclinations, if you like. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "I long for my ahbabi, ishtaqtu ila ikhwani. I long to see my brothers." And the companion said, "Are we not your brothers, O Messenger of Allah?" He said, "No, you are my companions, my brothers who will come afterwards. They will believe in me despite not seeing me. يَوَدُّ أَحَدُهُمْ لَوْ يَرَانِي بِمَالِهِ وَبِنَفْسِهِ. Each of them would wish to see me if it cost him his wealth and his soul." Are we of those whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam described as his brothers, whom he longs to see? Do we long to see him? Do we know him? Sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the question. Do we know him? You cannot love he whom you do not know. And you cannot long and yearn for what you don't know. So the claims of love of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam made by people whilst they defy him and his guidance and go against him and his tradition and his way is nothing but lip service, meaningless words. And the same goes for love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that was the first topic we started our series of Stations of the Believers with, love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He describes His Messenger saying, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And indeed you are upon great moral standing. Your khuluq, your character is azim, is great, perfect. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was given perfection, كَمَالٌ خُلُقِي وَخَلْقِي. Perfection in his character and in his form, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was not just perfect in his conduct. He was not just perfect in his worship. He was not just perfect in his speech. But he was perfect physically, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he is the most beautiful of mankind, described as being not too tall and not too short. His face so beautiful that the companion looked on a night where the moon was full and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appeared and he said, "I looked up and looked to the Messenger and looked to the moon and looked to the Messenger and could not decide who was more beautiful." Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Teeth pearly white, a smile so broad and magnetic, his laughter was smiling. His conduct would make you love him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So let us speak about some of his attributes, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. First of all, his khuluq, his character is perfect with Allah. His character is perfect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. before anyone else, because Allah is most worthy of perfection. So he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَدَّبَنِي رَبِّي فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي. My Lord taught me adab, manners. He gave me manners, فَأَحْسَنَ تَأْدِيبِي, and he perfected my manners. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his perfect conduct with his Lord were materialized in him finding pleasure and comfort and rest and peace in the worship of his Lord. Aisha radiallahu anha says that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would stand during the night for hours in qiyam and hours in ruku' and hours in sujood until his feet bled. They bled, they were swollen and bled from the sheer number of hours where he stood between the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She said, O Messenger of Allah, may Allah have mercy on you. Why do you exhaust yourself when Allah has forgiven you past and future sins? And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبَدًا شَكُورًا. Shall I not be a grateful slave? Because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his pleasure was found in salah. وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ, as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. And the comfort of my eyes was found in salah, was made for me in salah. وَجُعِلَتْ, it was made for him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That was the pinnacle of his adab, of his perfect manners and character with his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was shy of his Lord. He was shy of his Lord. And that shyness is shyness of ta'zeem. How can the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam be shy of his Lord? He doesn't disobey him. So what does he have to be shy about? He was shy of his Lord because he knew that he could never fulfill, he could never thank Allah as Allah deserves to be thanked. That he could never worship Allah as Allah deserves to be worshipped. Allah ascended him to the heavens, where he saw the angels and the messengers and the prophets. He saw Jannah, he saw Jahannam. He saw angels whose sole purpose for their creation was to worship Allah. So some who spend their entire life standing, and others who spend their entire life in ruku', and others who spend their entire life in sujood. And he said, the heavens are overburdened, overloaded, about to collapse from the sheer weight. And surely they should be overloaded, for there is not of a hand span except that there is an angel standing in prayer or in ruku' or in sujood. He saw this sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he and the messengers and prophets before him sought istighfar, sought forgiveness from Allah, because they knew that they could never worship Allah as he deserves to be worshipped. So where is our worship from the worship of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We knock out a couple of rak'at and we say, job done. Sorted. I'm safe now. Whereas the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his concern was not only for himself but for his ummah. How can we not love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he loved us? Not only does he long to see us, but he loved us and was concerned for us. Allah says, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِدْتُمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Indeed, a messenger has been sent from amongst you, for you. عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِدْتُمْ. It grieves him that you suffer. It grieves him. The pinnacle of love is that you grieve for the suffering of another. That's the pinnacle of love. And what suffering? That we are misguided. That's the suffering that the Messenger, that's what grieved the Messenger. That some of creation, or the majority of creation, would be misguided. It grieves him that you ail or that you suffer. حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. He is keen and eager for your interest. بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. Upon the believers, he is compassionate and merciful. And رَأْفَةٌ is greater than رَحْمَةٌ. Rahmah, mercy, is what everybody shows. Everybody expresses rahmah. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw a woman who had lost her child, and she was grieved and sad and upset and shocked and worried. And she asked, "Where is my son? Where is my son?" until she found him. And he said, "Do you see that woman's mercy over her child?" And he said, لَاللَّهُ أَرْأَفُ أَوْ أَرْحَمُ بِعِبَادِهِ مِنْهَا. Indeed, Allah is more merciful with his son than she is merciful with her son. And the Messenger, he was a mercy for us. And رَؤُوف, compassionate. Compassionate and merciful with us. He loved us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He loved us and cared for us. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Listen to the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, where she says the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood one night and he recited the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah, and he reached qawluhu ta'ala, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, speaking of mentioning Isa alayhi salam's dua, in tu'adhibhum fa innahum ibaduk. وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. And he would repeat it. إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ, if you punish them, فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ, they are your slaves. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the right. وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ, and if you were to forgive them, فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ, then indeed you are the Almighty, the All-Wise. And he would repeat it and repeat it and cry and cry. So Jibreel descended and he says, your Lord asks you, what makes you weep? And he knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, Ummati, Ummati. My nation, my nation. His concern was not for himself, but his concern is for us. So Allah reveals to Jibreel to inform his messenger, and he says, O Muhammad, your Lord reveals to you that he will not disappoint you in your ummah. He will not disappoint you in your ummah. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, I will not be pleased until all of my ummah are in paradise. Whose concern is greater for us than his? No one. No one is more concerned for us than him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On the day of judgment, where the people are gathered, and in the horror and terror of the day of judgment, every prophet, his dua will be, Allahumma sallim, Allahumma sallim. Oh Allah, secure, secure. And secure who? Himself. The prophets, except the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On that day he will say, Ummati, Ummati, my nation, my nation. That's the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's concern. You and I, every Muslim. Ali radiallahu anhu, he says, Arja ayatun fil Qur'an. The verse in the Qur'an that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had most hope in it is قوله تعالى وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And indeed your Lord shall grant you فَتَرْضَى, and you will be pleased. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I will not be pleased until all of my ummah are in paradise. How can we not love him if he loves us? How can we not love him if he sought ease for us? How did the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam seek ease for us? When he ascended to meet his Lord commanded him, his Lord commanded him to obligate his ummah with 50 prayers. And he met Musa alayhi salam and he said, return to your Lord and ask him to lessen the load, for I asked my people to do less and they did not keep them, the prayers. And he returned and returned and returned until the number was decreased to 5. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because he wished to facilitate ease for us and not difficulty, he returned to his Lord so that number is reduced to 5. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, they are 5 in number and 50 in reward. By virtue of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam's shafa'ah, his intercession, he interceded so that number is decreased. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not leave his house on the 4th day of Ramadan after he had prayed Taraweeh for 3 nights in a row. And the people, the number had increased and increased. And then on the 4th night, he did not leave his house. Why? Because he feared that if he led, then the Taraweeh would become obligatory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would prescribe it as an obligatory ibadah. So from his mercy for us is that he would leave our ibadah. Though he loves it, he would leave it for our sake. That's from his mercy for us. His mercy for us is that the salah was reduced in number. His mercy for us was that Taraweeh was not obligated for us. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was asked by Aisha one day. She said to him, O Messenger of Allah, make dua for me. And he said, Allahumma ighfir li Aisha ma qaddamat wa ma akharat wa ma asrarat wa ma a'lamat. O Allah, forgive Aisha what she has done and what she will do and what she has concealed and what she has concealed and what she has done openly. And Aisha cried and wept out of happiness. And her head fell into the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's lap. And he said, Do you find this astonishing? And she said, yes, O Messenger of Allah. Such a great dua. And he said, wallahi, that is my dua for the ummah in every prayer. His concern for us is greater than our parents' own concern is for us. His love for us is greater than our parents' love. So how can we not love him? How can we not love him and obey him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was not only the best with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was the best with his family. Aisha radiallahu anha says that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, if she drank from a cup, he would look for where she put her lips and he would place his lips to drink from there too. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam would speak to her gently and affectionately and call her Ya Aish. Ya Aish, an affectionate way of calling her name. He would wash from the same vessel, the same basin, the water basin that she would use. He would rest his head on her lap, radiallahu anha, and recite Quran and do dhikr, even when she's menstruating. He would kiss her, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, on the lips, whilst fasting before leaving for salah. And he would serve his family. He would cut the meat. He would mend his own sandals and sew his own clothes and clean up, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He would feed his family from what he ate outside. He would spend time with his family, knowing that they have a right to spend time with him. He went out on an expedition one day and Aisha was with him, and we know the story that he raced with her and she beat him. And years later they raced again. His love and his loyalty for Khadija radiallahu anha did not end with her death. If he ever slaughtered, he would take a share and give it to the friends and the family of Aisha. And when he heard Aisha's sister, after of course her passing, when he heard her sister's voice, he called out, when he heard the Khadija's sister after her passing, he heard her voice from behind the wall and he said, "Khadija, Khadija." And he came out. Aisha said, "I was never jealous of any of the wives of the Prophet as much as I was jealous of Khadija, and I never met her. And I never met her." On the day of Fath, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened Mecca for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to enter, can you imagine the hustle and the bustle? He's entered with an army of 10,000. And there are thousands who are at his mercy in Mecca. And everybody is clamoring to seek, to make an alliance with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to speak with him. And your politics at the highest level. And of course, a military campaign that has so much at stake. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meets an old woman. And then he walks off with her, he takes off his cloak, he puts it on the floor and lets her sit and speaks to her for a long time. And the companions say, "Who is this woman who has taken the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam away from such important proceedings?" And then afterwards the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "This woman was a friend of Khadija. Friend of Khadija. And I wish to sit with her to reminisce about the times of Khadija." Why mention this, my dear respected brothers? How are we with our wives and with our children? Are we like the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Are we as loving? Are we as loyal? Are we as affectionate? Are we as romantic as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is? We may give our wives the cold shoulder for weeks on end and then just turn to them to fulfill our carnal desire. Is that loyalty? Is that love? Is that what they deserve? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his speech, he was calm and moderate. He didn't speak about what didn't concern him. And he only spoke if there would be reward. If there was reward in what he would say, then he would speak. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With children, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his mercy for the children was shown where he would lead the salah, and if a baby cried or a child cried, then he would hasten, he would speeden. He would speed his salah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, out of mercy and compassion for that child, and mercy for the mother as well. He carried his granddaughter whilst in prayer. When he was delivering a khutbah one day, Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn, when they were toddlers, they ran in front of the minbar and they tripped up and fell. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could not bear. So he leaves the minbar. The companions are sat and listening to him. He leaves the minbar during the khutbah to go down, to carry them, to dust them off, and then put them on their way. And then he returns to the minbar. And he says, and he recites قوله تعالى إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. Indeed, your wealth and your children are a fitna, are a test for you. And he said, I could not cope whilst they were on the floor. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is this the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who is portrayed in the media? Is this the Messenger who is portrayed or described by some Muslims? A prophet of war, a prophet of fighting, a prophet of vengeance, a prophet of anger. Is this him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Or did they pick? Or did they pick tiny moments from his life and blow them out of proportion and mention them out of context? The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam would greet the small children in the street. Today, one hair on your beard goes grey, and that's it. You and the small and the younger generation, there's a cut-off. That's the cut-off point. You don't speak to each other. You don't greet one another. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would speak to the children. When walking through Medina and the children are playing, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam would come and look and ask them how they were. And they would run to greet him and hug him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Do the children run to us out of happiness to see us, or do they flee from us? One of the heads of a tribe, when he came to pledge allegiance to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he saw the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam kissing Al-Hasan al-Husayn. He said, "Do you kiss your young?" And he said, "Yes." He said, "I have 10 children whom I have never kissed." And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to him, "What can one do for you if Allah has stripped mercy from your heart? Man la yarham la yurham. He who does not show mercy is not shown mercy." Where's the mercy that we show our young? Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he would pray, and during his prayer, his grandsons Al-Hasan wal-Husayn would jump on his back. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam would remain in sujood until they finished playing. He would not push them off. Until they finished playing and were satisfied, then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam would rise up from sujood. Umar radiallahu anhu enters the house of the messenger and he sees Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn on his back, and they are riding the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's back, and he is on all fours sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Who are we talking about? We're talking about the master of mankind, a head of state, a messenger and a prophet, a leader. And he is on all fours with his grandchildren on his back. And Umar says, the best ride that they are riding. And the messenger says, rather the best riders who are riding. His love and his softness and his delicate nature, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. With Anas, who served the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam for 10 years, he said, "The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam never said to me once, for something that I did, why did you do that? And for something that I didn't do, why didn't you do that?" This is very difficult to understand. How can you teach and guide someone if you never give them an instruction? And the answer is that you lead by example. He sees your example and then he'll follow you. But if it is instructions barked and shouting, and it's of course very difficult to restrain yourself with your children, but let us take guidance from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Aisha said, "The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam never hit a woman or a servant." He never hit a woman or a servant, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Anas radiallahu anhu was sent by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam to do a chore. So Anas is a young boy. He goes out to do the Prophet's chore and he sees his friends playing in the street. So he gets distracted and plays with them. Then he, after a while, he feels a hand on his shoulder. And he turns around and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam says to him, "Anas, have you completed the chore?" And he said, "I'm doing it, O Messenger of Allah." And then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ushers him to go and continue the job. Softness. Whereas with our children, "Have you done this? Have you done that?" And then punishment will ensue if they haven't. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his mercy was not only for the believers. His mercy was for non-believers. Expelled by his own people in Mecca, and seeking an alliance and support elsewhere, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes to At-Ta'if. But the people of At-Ta'if greet him with the worst greeting and accuse him of being a liar. And they throw stones at him. And his feet bleed. And his face is bruised. And he runs. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrates himself, "I ran and I did not know which direction I ran in." When asked what was the most difficult day you experienced by Aisha, she asked him, "What was the most difficult day you experienced?" He said, "The day of Ta'if. The people cast me with stones, and the boys and the slaves were lined up to cast me with stones. I ran and I didn't know which direction I ran in. And I stopped and I did not know where I was." The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sat there. He leaned on a tree after hours of running, fleeing for his life. And he sits and he makes a heartfelt dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he says, "Oh Allah, Allahumma inni ashku ilayka. Oh Allah, I complain to you. The weakness of my will and my inability. If it is a punishment from you, then I accept. And if it is a test, then please relieve it." And the dua goes on. In that state, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends Jibreel with the angel of the mountains to give us context, brothers, to give us context. Why are we mentioning this? Because we all know the story. The angel of the mountains will say, "If you wish, I will engulf them with Al-Akhshabayn, the two mountains. I will engulf the people of Mecca." But the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says no. After all of that, he says no. "I hope that Allah brings forth from them those who will believe in Allah in the final day." And his dua is accepted. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His rahmah, he's not only, because his rahmah and his ra'fah are for the believers. But Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And we did not send you except as a mercy to all mankind. Not even man, the jinn. The jinn said to him that we are struggling with hunger. We're starving. And we have nothing for our beasts, our animals, to feed. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked them, "What is your food?" And he said, "The leftover bones from the food that you eat." And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commands the companions to not bury their bones and to leave it out, because it's food for your brothers of the jinn. His mercy wasn't for man, it wasn't for the believers only. It wasn't just for humankind, but for the jinn. It wasn't only just for those three, but for the animals. A bird came to him and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from his mu'jizat, from his miracles sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that the animals could speak to him and he would understand. And he said, who has frightened her by taking her chicks? And the companion said, "Us, O Messenger of Allah." They're hungry, they're on an expedition. And he says, "Return to her chicks," sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "for the feelings of a bird." The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sees the companions burning an anthill, and he stops them and he says, "None punishes with fire except the Lord of fire." And a donkey comes to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is speaking to it. The companions can see the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaking to a donkey, and he says, "Who's the owner of this donkey?" One of the companions says, "I am, O Messenger of Allah." And he says, "Your donkey complains to me about you, that you overloaded." He is not just rahma lil alameen. He's rahma to everything. He's mercy to everything. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What was his minbar? What did they use before a minbar? A pulpit was made for him. A log, brothers. A log. It wasn't a tree stump, it had no roots. It was a log. Lifeless. The Rasul ﷺ would lean on it in the mosque to deliver a khutbah. And when the pulpit was built, he stood. And the companions can hear a weeping in the mosque and turn and they would look around. And who's weeping? They can't see anyone weeping. And then the weeping would continue. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah revealed to him who's weeping. The log, my dear respected brothers, is weeping. So the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inanimate, lifeless objects. Inanimate objects love the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It was denied the touch of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so it wept. What science, what can explain this? Allah says, وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. And there is not of a thing except that it glorifies His praise, Allah's praise. وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. But you do not understand their tasbih, their glorification, how they do it. A thing, that means lifeless objects, they're things, but they praise Allah and glorify Him. And just as they glorify Allah, they love Allah and they love His Messenger. So the lifeless log wept that the Rasul left it. So the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam descends from his pulpit and goes and he hugs the log and speaks to the log and says to it some words that pleased it, and then it stopped crying. He's a rahmah for everything. Everything, my dear respected brothers and sisters. Everything. And it is because we don't know this that we then don't follow him. We don't know this, so we do not love him as he should be loved. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As for his zuhd, his asceticism, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose to be a abd and the Rasul, a slave and messenger, than to be a king. He was granted the choice to live as an eternal king, to live as an eternal king, but he chose the company of the highermost companion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would lie down in his house, and his house is what? Imagine this mosque here. And then we put a curtain, like the curtain during the last 10 nights, for those who do i'tikaf. That's the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's house. And then partition for each of his wives. That's his house. It's not a house. But that's what's called the house. Anyway, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would lie on a weed mat. And Umar entered one day and he saw the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam get up after lying down, and it had left marks on his side, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Umar wept and he says, "What makes you weep, O Umar?" And he said, "Caesar and Kisra, the king of Persia, they live in opulence and luxury. And you, O Messenger of Allah, live in this harsh and difficult condition." And he said, "O Umar, are you not pleased or are you not content for them to have the dunya and for us to have the akhirah?" Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He would sit on the floor, not on a throne. When the people entered the mosque from outside of Medina, they would say, "Ayyukum Muhammad?" Who amongst you is Muhammad? What does that mean, my dear respected brothers? He did not distinguish himself in how he dressed, in how he sat, in how he was amongst people. He would sit with kings and with slaves alike. There was no difference. He did not differentiate between people. He did not give people special treatment over others. He did not give people worldly privileges over others. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would accept the invitation from everyone. And he would accept the invitation to any type of food. Any type of food. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَوْ أُهْدِيَ إِلَيَّ كِرَاعٌ لَقَبِلْتُ. If I was given as a gift, sheep feet, kirar, I would accept it. وَلَوْ دُعِيتُ عَلَيْهِ لَأَجَبْتُ. And if I was invited to it, I would eat it. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would accept an invitation to the outskirts of Medina to eat rough barley bread, bread made out of barley, with moldy butter. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha says, the crescent would come, and a crescent would come and pass, and a crescent would come and pass, and the crescent would come, and we would, and no fire would be lit in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Meaning 2 months would go by and no food is cooked. And her nephew says, "Oh khala, what did you use to sustain yourself with?" And she said, "Al aswadain, dates and water." Dates and water, my dear respected brothers. That's what the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam sustained himself with. Did he ever complain? Did he ever ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for more of the dunya or anything of the dunya? No, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He saved his dua for us. He saved his dua for us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His worship, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we spoke of. He was constant in dhikr. He was constant in dhikr. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "Indeed, my eyes sleep, but my heart does not sleep from the dhikr of Allah." A special privilege of the prophets, that in their sleep, they perform dhikr. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while he sat, he's continuously performing istighfar, saying, "Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah." He said, لأن أقول سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر أحب إلي مما طلعت عليه الشمس. That I say سبحان الله الحمد لله لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر. It is more beloved to me than what the sun rises upon, the dunya. It's more beloved to him than the dunya. Whereas for us, to say a quick dhikr in the morning before we leave, no, we have to rush to our work. Tayyib, while you're rushing, make some dhikr. No. Wallahi, such a person is mahroom. He's mahroom. He's denied. He's prevented. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to prevent us his dhikr. His sacrifice that he made, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sacrificed for us. So today we sit in a mosque, and that I'm called Muhammad, and you're called Abdullah, and you're called Ahmed, and Mustafa, and Mahmoud, and we're Muslim, and that we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sacrificed. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he called everyone. He called his family, and he called his friends, and he called the Arabs, and he called all of the world to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He called everyone, because he was sent, the prophets would be sent before him, the prophets would be sent to their people, khassa, specifically, to their own people. And he was sent to the world, amma. He was sent to the entire world, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he endured abuse and hardship in his da'wah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Mecca, whilst praying at the Kaaba, he had the amniotic sac of a newborn camel. The amniotic sac, blood and membranes and liquids, thrown on his head, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whilst in sujood. And if he were to move, it would tip and the liquid would fall on him. So he waits until his daughter comes, Fatima, and she moves it off him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the battle of Uhud, He has his skull fractured, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his jaw broken, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as there is an onslaught against him to kill him and eradicate his da'wah. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam endures. And when he goes onto the mountain of Uhud, the mountain shakes. And he says, Uthbut Uhud, remain firm, Uhud, for on your back is a messenger and the Siddiq and two martyrs, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman. He says to it, remain firm. You don't have any normal people on your back. You have Allah's messenger on your back. Umar says, O Messenger of Allah, make dua against them. After the Rasul is bleeding from his head. The companion said we could not see his face from the blood. He's bleeding, and Umar says, O Messenger of Allah, make dua against them. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raises his hand, and the companions are anticipating a dua against Quraysh. And he says, Allahumma hdi qawmi fa'innahum la ya'lam. Oh Allah, guide my people, for indeed they do not know. They don't know. And he gives them the excuse of ignorance, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his teaching, he was not harsh. He was not grueling in his methods. A man came to him and he said to him, O Messenger of Allah, grant me permission to perform zina. Can you imagine this? Somebody coming to the Messenger of Allah and saying to him, allow me to fornicate. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, calmly he says to him, would you accept it for your mother? And he said, no. And he said, nor do people accept it for their mothers. Would you accept it for your sister? And he said, no. He said, nor will people accept it for their sisters. Would you accept it for your auntie? And he said, no. He said, nor do people accept it for their aunties. The man is quiet. And he said, O Messenger of Allah, give me an option. And the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wipes on his chest. And he says, Allahumma ghafir dhanba. Oh Allah, forgive his sin. Wa tahhir qalba, and purify his heart. Wa hassin farja, and fortify his loins. Subhanallah. And the man said, I never thought of zina afterwards. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was kind and merciful and gentle. Let's imagine now someone walks in and urinates in the corner. Again, we need to put things into perspective. Imagine us now sat down as we are, someone comes in and wees in the corner. What would our reaction be? Shock and anger. The companions, they were angered too. When the Arabi, when the Bedouin walked in, and the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, leave him, let him finish. And then he commands that a bucket of water is poured over it. Tayyib, that's eradicated the najasa now, eradicated the impurity. And he says to the man, the mosques were built for salah and dhikr, and not for this. That's it. And then the man, he sits and listens to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he loves what he has to say. So then he says, oh Allah, have mercy on me and Muhammad and no one else but you, and no one else but us. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you have restricted something that's very wide and broad. But from his love of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he saw from him conduct and a way of teaching that he'd never seen in his life. So how are we, my dear respected brothers, when it comes to knowledge of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is it not a shame? Is it not a massive disappointment that we would know the lives of politicians, and of sports personalities and of celebrities more than we know the life of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You'll find people who are proud of quotes for Gandhi, Mandela, even Thatcher, Malcolm X, even Muslims, no worry. But if you ask him, can you tell me a hadith of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Maybe nothing, maybe, or maybe something, but very little. The biographies will be stacked on their shelves. Intellectuals, people who are enlightened, people who are high and lofty in their way of thinking. And you see the biographies, and even of obscure people that maybe are not known, are not so popular. And they're proud that they know their lives. If you say, do you know how old the Prophet ﷺ was when he first received the revelation? I don't know. How old was the Rasul ﷺ? Or how long was the da'wah in Mecca? I don't know. When was Fathu Mecca? I don't know. Isn't that shameful, my dear respected brothers, that we don't know anything about the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life? Or that amongst us there are people who don't know anything about the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life? Wallahi, it's shameful. It's shameful. How can you claim love of someone whom you don't know? How can you claim to follow someone who you don't know? How can you claim adherence to somebody who you don't know? You go to a job interview and the first thing you're asked is, so what do you know about us? What do you know about this job, about this company, about what we do? They want to test. You're not just there for a job to make money. But we don't know. How can we expect to be in his company on the Day of Judgment and drink a sip of water from his noble hands, after which our thirst will be quenched for eternity, if we don't know him sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How can we accept to receive his shafa'ah when we don't send salah and salam on him? How? All questions that we must ask ourselves. And we start with ourselves. Yes, brothers, we start with ourselves, not with others. We start with ourselves. Umar says, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Take yourselves to account before you are taken to account. وَزِنُوا أَعْمَالَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُوزَنَ عَلَيْكُمْ. And weigh your deeds before they're weighed against you. So let us all reflect on this point. The love of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my dear respected brothers, is a condition of iman. It's a condition of iman. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, none of you shall believe. This is proper belief. None of you shall believe until I am more beloved to him than his self and his money and his family and his own self. Than his own self, my dear respected brothers and sisters. Do we love the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than we love ourselves? Everyone will say yes. A sign of loving the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than ourselves is that we prioritize him and his command and his sunnah over our own opinion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَا كَانَ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It is not for the believers that if Allah and His Messenger rule on a matter that they return to their own opinions. No. If the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says something, then it is not for us to postulate over whether we should do it or shouldn't do it. If it is obligatory, then we do it. If it's recommended, then we strive to increase in it. If it's haram, we refrain from it entirely. If it's makruh, then we try and avoid it. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, what I have commanded you to do, then try and do from it as much as you are able to. And what I have forbidden you from doing, then abstain from it entirely. So my dear respected brothers and sisters, do we have that love? Do we love the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than ourselves? Do we love him more than our own opinion? Do we love his guidance more than our own opinion? A question we should all ask ourselves. And then, to expand from ourselves to our closest circle, our family, and then our friends, and our community, our colleagues, and our community, the people we see in the masjid. My dear respected brothers and sisters, the path to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the path of the Rasuls. There is no other path. Allah says, قُلْ say, يعني O Muhammad, say, هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي. This is my path. Sabil is singular. This is my path. أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. I call to Allah, عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ, with knowledge and insight. أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي. I and those who follow me. So my dear respected brothers, the path to Allah is one, and every other path leads to misguidance. So let us all follow the path of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Let us all learn more about the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that we may love him. Because the more we know about him, the more we love him. And the more we love him, the more we'll obey him. And the more we love him, the more we'll yearn to be with him. If we wish to see him in this life, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us that blessing that we see him in this life. For the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, he who sees me in his sleep will see me during his consciousness. If we see the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our sleep, then Allah will not deny us seeing him on the Day of Judgment. And because he is a mercy, if Allah permits and grants and wills for us to gaze upon him on the Day of Judgment, then we will be included in Allah's mercy. But the mahroom, the one who is prevented and denied, then he is the one who will be prevented and denied mercy on the Day of Judgment. For that mercy will come through the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the Day of Judgment. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us his intercession. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us company of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to enable us and to honor us by gazing upon him in the Akhirah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us a sip of water from his noble hands, after which our thirst will be quenched for eternity. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to admit us into paradise with him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani so much can be said, and so much has been missed, my dear respected brothers. But we'll finish with this. One of the companions, he came to the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, weeping. And he said, O Messenger of Allah, I sit in my home amongst my family, and I think about you and the station Allah has reserved for you in Jannah. And then I remember that I will never reach that level. So then I am saddened and depressed. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had no response for him. He only speaks by his Lord's permission. Allah then revealed, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصُّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. And he who obeys Allah and the Messenger will be with those whom Allah has bestowed his bounty and favor upon, مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ, from the prophets, والصديقين, the truthful, والشهداء, the martyrs, والصالحين, the pious, وحسن أولئك رفيقا. And great indeed is such company. The Messenger says, المرء مع من أحب. Man is with whom he loves on the Day of Judgment. So choose, my dear respected brothers, carefully who you love. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to love us and to grant us the love of His awliya and love, of course, of His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us our sins, what we have done and what we will do, and what we have concealed and what we have revealed, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala engulfs us in His mercy. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا brothers. إن شاء الله next week we'll resume with our normal series إن شاء الله جزاكم الله خيرا.
Very good general question. The videos you have, they're not online on the website.
They're not my videos, brother Ferdi. All of the other a'imma, all, I think, give him permission to upload on his page.
Oh, so it's not recorded for the Islam Mosque?
No. The content that comes from this mosque is not exclusive and is not property of the mosque.
Okay. And we were hoping to reuse some of the videos, but it's not online. Okay. I'll
give it to him,
inshallah. I see you every week. I'll come back. I'll see you tomorrow, inshallah.
Bi'idhnillah. Jazakumullah khairan, Allah yibarik fikum. الله يبارك فينا إن شاء الله جزاكم الله خير.